You know, the area that we call the North Pacific Gyre is as remote as you can get from human civilization anywhere on Earth. It's halfway between Hawaii and the mainland of California. There are very few places on Earth where you can get that far away from human civilization, so I expected to see nothing. And I had indeed traveled from California to Hawaii as a young man, 14 years old, with my father on a sailboat, and never experienced in 1961 any plastic in the ocean. So when I was returning from Honolulu in 1997, and 97 was a kind of a unique year because it was the largest El Nino ever recorded in the Pacific. It flattened the water virtually from Hawaii to the mainland. It was completely calm. And so it gave all that plastic that was there a chance to float to the surface. And so because it was calm and because I would come on deck and look, I would see a piece of trash floating by just every time I looked, and I would make a bet with myself. Okay, you're gonna come on deck this time, you're gonna stand and you're gonna look and you're not gonna see anything. And I would always lose the bet, because within 5 or 10 minutes, not like it is now where it's more than you can count, but in 1997 it was every 5 or 10 minutes I would see something floating by. But it still bothered me because I was a ocean lover, a surfer, a sailor, basically a marine mammal, and I was bothered by my habitat not being clean. And so I thought to myself, well, this can't be like a fairy tale with Hansel and Gretel with somebody leaving a trail of little cookie crumbs for me to follow home. This must be a larger phenomenon than what I'm seeing. It can't be just for me, because it just would be very improbable for that to happen. So I came back 2 years later. I told people about this situation. I said, there's something going on here. I don't know what it is. It has to do with the high pressure zone out here. I need to find out how much is out there, what's going on. And so we developed scientific sampling methods. And I spoke to oceanographers and scientists that work in the ocean, and basically found out that the best way for me to sample this was a net called a mannitrol, which has a wide mouth and wings, and is basically doing the same thing as a manta ray. It's sifting the ocean for plankton. But when we pulled up our net and looked at the contents after sampling out there, we found that in the lab we determined 6 kilos of plastic for every kilo of plankton in the net. Well, this was explosive. This blew the whole lid off the whole thing. No one could ignore this anymore. Even the marine debris conferences were not focused on plastic before that time. They were looking at other problems rather than just plastic. But now it's all focused on plastic, and the amount has gone up exponentially. And the interest in the subject has also gone up exponentially. When I first started looking for other people who were curious about plastic in the ocean, I found one paper being published every year. Now there's one every day. So the situation is explosive. The global south is now experiencing this problem. I've just returned from the South Pacific Gyre and found that it's heavily polluted with plastic as well. We're seeing the same phenomenon there as we saw in the North Pacific Gyre. So because we have an exponential increase in a problem and an exponential increase in interest in the problem, there's a lot of emphasis on what are we going to do about this. And I don't believe we can solve it under the current economic paradigm of infinite growth, pushing out more and more resources, more and more variety, more and more really things people don't need but are curious about enough that they might want to buy. We've got to rein in our use of plastic. And this is a very hard message for our economy, because the economy demands growth, the environment demands reduction. So we have this contradiction, and it's part of the contradiction of the historical era that we're living in. So are we going to have another dark age where we refuse to admit our problem and do something about it? Or are we going to come to our senses, elect intelligent leaders, and deal with it? Right now we have what we call in the United States a caucusocracy, ruled by the stupidest among us. We can't possibly fix the problem by having leaders that have no understanding of what issues are that are affecting humanity. So managing all the contradictions that we have in our current system is the problem for our leaders, and managing won't cure the problem. It's not going to do it. We can't find a way to manage our way, to recycle our way, to get our way through this. Only way we can do it is to create a steady state economy, a circular economy, something that has the potential to infinitely progress without destruction. Right now, our paradigm is linear. It has a certain amount of destruction with a high amount of progress. We need to rein that in and bring it back into a circular economy. That's the only solution. It's a radical solution, but crazy times demand radical solutions. Well, we estimate about 20% from ships at sea and about 80% from land, yeah. If you think of just the coasts being the sides of a tub, the wind blowing the water against the side, it creates this circular motion. And that circular motion produces a concentration of debris in the center. We have them in all of our oceans. It's the accumulation zones are prevalent everywhere in the world ocean, in these central basins. It's by the time it gets to these garbage patches, it's mostly polypropylene and polyethylene, the olefins. Number one is not there because it sinks. The bottle cap, though, number one is the bottle, but the bottle cap is a number five, which floats. So the bottle caps is a big problem. That's why we've started the Save the Albatross Coalition to leash the lid to the bottle, because there's more bottle caps in the ocean than there are bottles, and it's killing the albatross. They're picking them up and feeding them to their chicks. Well, the reaction truly was explosive. When we told the media that there was more plastic than life in the ocean, there was a lot of interest, and I became a media figure, and people came to me when they wanted to talk about this issue. They're still coming to me with this new video that came out from a fella in Bali that did this underwater video showing all the plastic throughout the water column. They came to me to ask me what I thought about that, and I told them that what impressed me was that it's weaving itself into the fabric of life. It occupies the entire water column. It's getting into every form of life. It's in the air. A study in Paris found between 3 and 10 tons of plastic fiber falling out of the air every year. We're finding it in our water. We're finding it in our salt. It's truly ubiquitous. It has this way of weaving itself. It's enough like living tissue to weave itself into the tissue of life. We have no idea what that means, and it's not being addressed sufficiently. It's increasing at an exponential rate, and our knowledge and reaction is going at an extremely slow pace by comparison. It's the responsibility of the entire society, but the people that profit from it, who have money from it, should be involved in dealing with the problem. Absolutely. It's called extended producer responsibility. We must demand that those who make us our problems deal with the problems.